simple question tonight as we look in Mark chapter 9. What are you bringing to Jesus? What are you bringing to Jesus? Every time we get to the beginning of a new year, people have, well, I'll make this resolution, I'll do this, I'll do that. What are you bringing to Jesus? And what are you asking God to do in your life this year? And there's two questions that we'll look at and kind of answer up front. You know, what does Father bring to Jesus? And then what does the Father want? I reckon the better question to ask, well, what did Jesus do in that situation? Mark chapter 9, verse 22, 23, and 24. Actually, we're going to do the last part of 22, and then we'll go back and catch the context of this. The last part of verse 22, Mark chapter 9. But if you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. And Jesus said to him, if you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. And immediately the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. We've got to go back and look at the context of what this was written in, and some of you might know what that context is, but to understand it, let's look at it together. Go back to verse 14, and we're going to start there. We're just going to kind of walk through here just a little bit, and then I'm going to ask you, what are you bringing to Jesus? Verse 14, and when he came to disciples, he meaning Jesus, came to disciples. Now, where was Jesus at? Back in verse 2, in verse 3 and verse 4, it tells us that Jesus took Peter, James, and John, led them up on a high mountain apart by themselves, and he was transfigured before them. His clothes became shining, exceedingly white like snow, such as no launderer on earth can whiten them. And Elijah appeared to them and with Moses, and they were talking with Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration. That's where they were. And they were up there, and Moses and Elijah appears to Jesus and talks with him, and Peter, James, and John are up there, and later on, Peter says, hey, Jesus, this is so cool. Why don't we just build some tents up here and just hang out here forever? And we want to just stay here because this is a great thing that's going on. Jesus, we just got it happening. And Jesus, we just want to stay up here forever and ever and ever. And all of a sudden, there's a voice comes out of the heavens saying, this is my son, I'm proud of him. Listen to him. And then Moses and Elijah was taken back up into the cloud, and Jesus and Peter, James, and John then comes down from the mountain. And so he came to the disciples. Don't know why the other disciples were not up there. Maybe they were down there kind of crowd control, guarding the time. Jesus said, y'all need to stay here. Don't go up on the mountain. He's up there with Peter, James, and John, and they're up there having a prayer time, and they need some alone time, and we need to stay down here. Maybe the disciples were down there kind of crowd control. Bible solid on that. All we know is he takes Peter, James, and John. They go up into the mountain. They come back down, and when they come down, it says he saw a great multitude around them. There's a bunch of people hanging out there now. There's a bunch of crowds around them, around the disciples, and scribes disputing with them. The scribes were disputing with them, meaning the other disciples. We don't know what the scribes were disputing about, but we want to have an idea here in just a little bit what they could have possibly been doing. But we need to understand the scribes and who they were. The scribes were special office that you trained for to do in the work of the church. It started about age 13. After a boy passed his bar mitzvah, his mama and daddy said, I think you would make a good church worker. And so they would go, and they would go down to Jerusalem, and they would find a rabbi down there who had a school and had an opening, somebody they wanted their boy to study with. And around age 13, then they would assign this boy and apply, and if he was accepted, then the rabbi took upon this boy as one of his disciples and to teach them. And usually it lasted for 17 years. So around age 30, so for 13 years old, he goes into this training. At age 30, he is released from the training to go out and begin his work. Some of them became doctors of law. In other words, they became lawyers. Others arbitrated family litigation. And the family squabbles was going on. You know, when the fellow came to Jesus and said, will you help me decide and tell my brother to divide the inheritance with me? And so forth. Some of them would have been involved in that. Some of them became heads of school, and others became members of the Sanhedrin, because the scribes became experts, interpreters of the law. In fact, one of the things that they did, they were transcribers. We here at Old St. George, Ms. Linda is our transcriber, doing business meetings. She takes the records of what happened and what we have decided to do, and she transcribes those down in what we know as the minutes. And so some of them were transcribers. Some of them copied the law, made copies of the law, Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, and the prophets, so that it could be used in synagogues. So they transcribed. They were scribers who then wrote down word for word and moved it over and made copies so the synagogues could have it. Some of them wrote out contracts. If somebody said, "Hey, I'm going to sell this piece of land to this person over here," the scribes helped with the translation of that and the translating of that, and they would write the contracts out of that. They would make covenants when a man and a woman was espoused. There was a legal document drawn up between the two parties, and they would help do that. If there was some repudiation, like a divorce decree, because divorce was allowed, at some time they would give them divorce decrees, or there was some type of affidavit needed to dissolve something, they took care of that. So these are the guys that are down there arguing with the disciples. Now, we don't know what they're arguing about, but in a little bit we're going to come back to that and talk about it. So we see Jesus come down, he sees the disciples, and there's a big crowd, and the scribes are fussing and arguing with them. And verse 15, it says, immediately when they saw him, the disciples saw him, and all the people, they were greatly amazed. Another one of the accounts in the scripture says his face was glowing like the sun when he came down. And so they were amazed, and they ran to him, and they greeted him. Now, this is what they kind of greeted, "Hey, Jesus, how you doing?" Just kind of high-five a little bit. I mean, they was hugging, embracing, and man, it's good to see you. I imagine the disciples are like, "Thank God he's down here, because we need these guys," and they raking us over the coals, and they are chewing us out about something, and we got Jesus here. He's going to help us out here. And so they ran to Jesus, and they greeted him. Verse 16. And so Jesus asked, who did he ask? He asked a question of somebody. Who did he ask? The scribes. He doesn't look at the disciples and say, "Okay, guys, what's going on here?" He doesn't look at the crowd and say, "Okay, guys, what's going on? Help me out here." No, he looked at the scribes and said, "Okay, guys, what are you arguing about? What you doing out here? What's going on?" And that's a prayer key right there. That's a key to prayer right there. He asked the scribes, "What are you discussing with them? What's going on?" Well, he asked the scribes, because they probably caused the uproar anyway. And what did they respond? If you look in verse 17, it says, "One from the multitude answered and said, Teacher, I brought my son to you who has a mute spirit." The scribes, who caused an uproar, who's egging this thing on, fueling this argument that's going on, when Jesus said, "Okay, what are you talking about? What are you arguing about? What are you crying up here and got this thing going on about?" The scribes said, "Nothing." Beware of those who want to give you all kind of advice, but when confronted with what they're doing, they hush up and leave you out on the edge of a ledge by yourself. And that's what they did. And so Daddy speaks up in verse 17. It says, "One from that multitude answered and said, Teacher, I brought my son to you who has a mute spirit. And whenever he seizes him, he throws him down, he foams at the mouth, he gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. So I spoke to your disciples that they should cast him out, but they could not." So Daddy says, "Listen, Jesus, let me tell you what's happening, because the scribes are not saying anything. Let me tell you what happened. I brought my son to you, but because I couldn't see you, you were unavailable, I asked your disciples to take care of my son, and they could not." Now, it's interesting. The English translation uses the word teacher. In the Greek, the word there for that's used here, that's translated in our English translation as teacher, sometimes it's translated as teacher, sometimes it's translated as rabbini, or rabboni, meaning teacher, great teacher. Other times it is translated as doctor. Now, that makes more sense to me. Jesus didn't come up and said, "Jesus, I just want you to teach my son about a couple of things." He didn't come asking him to teach him something. He came because he knew what was going on with his son wasn't normal, wasn't right. And he wanted something done about it. So he didn't come and say, "Jesus, I want you to sign him up and carry him under your wing for a little while and teach him a few things." No, he said, "Doctor, I want you to do something, because I brought him to you so you can cast this thing out of him, whatever's got him going on, and I want you to do it. I brought my son to you. But because I couldn't see you, I asked your disciples to take care of my son." Now, notice what he says in verse 18. He said, I asked your disciples, that I spoke to them, that they should cast them out, but they could not. Now, cast out here has two ideas. One is to compel him to depart. So on one, if you're looking at it, the compelling part, he wanted the disciples to say, boy, get out of here and go home. I don't want you around here. Just leave. Get out of here. Get the disciples to push away so they couldn't do it. I don't think that's what they were wanting. I don't think he was wanting him just to be moved out of the crowd. The other word means to deprive of power and influence. I think that's what he wanted. He said, my boy, something's happening to my boy that's seizing him and having power and influence over him, and I want that cast out of him, and I don't want him having that. See, the father want the son to be thrown out of the crowd. He didn't want him to stop what he was doing. He wanted him to be set free. And he recognized, this thing that's happened to my son, just not normal. It's not normal. And I think this is what the scribes were arguing about. See, in the Old Testament law, that they were experts at, a son who was disobedient to mom and daddy, and was constantly been disobedient and disruptive in the crowd and everything else, the law said take them outside after you warn him and try to discipline them, and if he refuses to do it, I mean, take them outside and stone him to death. Get rid of the thing. Purge it from your mess and all. And I can hear these scribes right now. Man, why don't you take that boy outside and stone him? Man, if he was ever out of my house, we wouldn't be doing that. I wouldn't allow him to do this. You need to stop pampering that boy. Because they were experts on everything. And I think, the disciples are down there, and the family's there saying, okay, we're going to keep the crowd back so Jesus and Peter, James, and John can enjoy the time up on the mountain with the Father for a while, because they need to go up there and talk, and then they're going to come back now, and y'all just need to hang out here for a little while. And the daddy says, I brought him, and I looked for you, and I couldn't find you, so I asked your disciples to do this, and I could see some busybody scribe going, well, why are you going to him for? Jesus ain't got the credentials we got. Man, we went in, we started at 13, and for the last 17 years, we've been doing this, and we've got our own place, and we've got all the credentials, we've got all the things hanging on the wall, we got all the credentials, and everybody knows that we can do it, and what are you going to these folks for? I think the scribes and the neighbors down there argued with them. It's because they had a thousand ways that we can expel that boy and get rid of this thing. We got a thousand ways why you don't have the authority, but we do, and we can go on and on and on. And I think the scribes were there, they're arguing from their standpoint, because the man went to see Jesus and didn't come to see them. But we need to look and see what happens. What did the new spirit do? He says it seizes him, it overtakes him, it causes him not to be able to speak. It says he throws him down. That word throws down means he's trying to break him into pieces and causes him to distort and to convulse in all kind of weird shapes. It says he foams at the mouth. He gnashes his teeth. Now that word gnashes, not only means does he put his teeth together and grind them, but he makes groaning and growling noise. But it says not only that, it says that he becomes rigid. He withers up like a dry plant. Verse 22, notice what it says over in verse 22. And he often throws him into the fire and into the water to destroy him. He says, I brought my boy to you, Jesus. Your disciples couldn't do anything about it. And notice what Jesus does in verse 19. Jesus answered the man. This is kind of a subtle rebuke and then an invitation to join Jesus. Oh, faithless generation, how long shall I be with you? How long shall I bear with you? Bring that boy to me. And what happened? It says in verse 20, then they brought the boy to Jesus. And when the boy saw Jesus, immediately the spirit convulsed him. He goes into one of the fits and the seizures that he's been having. And he fell on the ground and he wobbled and he foamed at the mouth. And so Jesus asked the Father, how long has this been happening? Here's another prayer key right there. How long has this been going on?
And Daddy said, well, they just started yesterday. No, that's not what he said.
Oh, he was born this way.
No, that's not what he said.
He said he started this in childhood. Something happened to this boy. Then all of a sudden, something happens and takes possession of this boy, that now he has seizures and convulsions, foams at the mouth, falls down, and throws into the fire, throws into the water, all kind of stuff going on. Daddy's knowing this is not normal, because my boy, up to this time, he had been normal. Now, after this time, something was possessing him that was not right, and I can pinpoint when this started. And then he goes on. Not only did he say from childhood, but then he says, and he has often been thrown into the fire and into the water in order to be destroyed. And if you can do anything, Jesus, have compassion on us and help us. And Jesus said to him, if you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. And immediately the father of the child cried out and said with tears, Lord, I believe. Help my unbelief. And when Jesus saw the people come running together because the crowd came there, he rebuked the unclean spirit, saying to him, you deaf and dumb spirit, I command you come out of him and enter him no more. Then the spirit cried out, convulsed him greatly, came out of him, and he became as one as dead. So the many said, he's dead. But Jesus took him by the hand, lifted him up, and he rose. And when he had come into the house, his disciples asked him privately, why could we not cast him out? And so he said to him, this kind can come out by nothing but prayer and fasting. That's another prayer key right there. Some things take prayer and fasting. And so notice what Jesus does. He listens to the man. He asks him a couple of questions. And then the father says, Lord, I believe you can do anything, but help my unbelief. See, that is a key to us praying. When we bring something to Jesus, that is part of the key to our prayer life. See, Jesus does not require you to have mountains of faith, but he does require you to have genuine faith. Daddy's saying, notice what Daddy's saying. If you can do anything, have compassion on us and help us. And Jesus said, if you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. And immediately the father said, Lord, I believe. What he was saying is, I have faith in you. I believe that you are the Son of God. I believe that you can do whatever you say. But in this moment, help me because I am wavering. How many of us have issues that we wrestle with in our life and we take to Jesus and we have no problem believing that he is God Almighty, that he can do whatever he says he can do, but we wrestle with giving this to Jesus? That's what he's doing. I don't know what your situation is. Here at the beginning of 2019, I don't know what you ended 2018 with. I don't know what you got fixing here in 2019, even though I know some of your life stories and what's going on with you right now. The question is, what are you bringing to Jesus? And are you willing to say, Jesus, I believe that you can do whatever you say you can do, but I am struggling right now to get my fingers off this and let you have it. See, there are some prayer keys in this passage we looked at. One is you got to be honest with Jesus because he knows anyway. You got to be honest with Jesus because Jesus asked himself a question. He asked a scribe, what are you discussing with him? Why are you talking to my guys? Why are you trying to get them to do? Why are you talking to these folks? What are you doing? He's saying, let's be honest. He said, what are you bringing to Jesus? Be honest with what that deal is. Be honest with you, because he knows all about it anyway. Jesus was not caught off guard, but he left the mountain, come down and found that crowd going on. He knew what was going on already. But notice the other key when he asked. Remember, he asked the Father, verse 21, how long has this been happening? How long has it been going on? Part of praying when you're coming and saying, God, I'm struggling with this, and I'm bringing to you, and I want you to do something. I brought my boy to Jesus. Jesus, I brought him to you. Doctor, I came because I believe that you can do something about it. I've seen you do other things. I've seen you heal others. And God, I've seen you do this and everything. We need to confess what we saw at the beginning. Because see, sometimes we're in that shape because of us and what we've done. We need to begin confessing when it began. God, you know, I was walking well with you. And God, I was trusting you in all things. But at this moment, I know this is about when I started tripping up. And then notice what the Father did. Lord, I believe, help my unbelief. Ask for faith to be strengthened for God's glory. Notice he didn't say, boy, give me a brand new voice so I can go home and be proud of the boy I got.
Because I think he was proud of the boy he had. I don't want to be embarrassed with my boy. Man, he's doing all good. No, he wasn't embarrassed. He was just saying, Jesus, my boy's got something going on, and I need some deliverance there. And he needs some deliverance, and God's going to get the glory. That's why he brought him to Jesus, not took him to the scribes. So let me ask you this question. What are you bringing to Jesus? Notice what man says in verse 17. Teacher or doctor, I see you healing others. I see you doing all this. So, doctor, I brought my son to you who has a mute spirit. And I'm expecting you to do something about it. In verse 23, Jesus says, if you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. Now, he's not saying you can sit around and go, well, I believe I'm going to win the Mega Millions jackpot because I want that $450 million, however much it is. I believe that, so I'm going to just sit here and pray. I'll just believe I'll win that. So let me just go get a ticket. Oh, I believe that I'm going to get a new car. No. See, there are a lot of guys and gals out there preaching the prosperity gospel. The problem with prosperity gospel is it's never glorifying God. It's all about what I want and glorifying me. I can say, I got a new car, I got a new house, I made millions. It's not about us, it's about God. He called us to be stewards of what he's given anyone. And anyway, notice what he says. If you can believe, all things are possible to him who believes. See, everything is possible for the one who believes. And that word believes means who has genuine faith. Maybe that's one reason we don't see some things happening today that we saw in the scriptures or hear about at other times and other places. It's not that we don't believe that Jesus is the Son of God and God is the Father and the Son and the Holy Spirit, that he can do all things and he brings healing and everything, but maybe we're wrestling at that moment in our faith and saying, God, I'm struggling right here. See, we need to be honest with God. I think what the man was saying is simply this: I believe some things, but will you help me to overcome when I'm struggling to believe? What about you tonight? What are you bringing to Jesus? What are you bringing to Jesus? Teacher, doctor, I brought my son to you. He has a mute spirit. It seizes him. It throws him down. He foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth. He becomes rigid. How long has this been happening? Since he was a wee boy. It's often thrown him into the fire to destroy him. Thrown him into the water to destroy him. That's what's been happening. But if you can do anything, Lord, I believe you can do anything. But I'm struggling with the compassion in you helping us right now because I don't know how to help. I don't know what's going on. I believe some things, but will you help me overcome where I'm struggling to believe? Maybe in your prayer time, in your prayer life as you're beginning 2019, you need to say, God, I believe some things, and I trust some things even with my core. But will you help me to overcome when I'm struggling to believe? Because I'm bringing my boy to you. But let me give you a warning. When you bring it to Jesus, you've got to beware of who you're seeking advice from. He wanted Jesus, but he ended up getting the loudmouth scribes around him. The experts who thought they knew everything when he needed Jesus. Jesus is the only one who could take care of it. But they was out there, carrying him to the helpers, the disciples. I brought him to the helpers. I know they've seen you doing it. But they couldn't do a thing, Jesus. But you can. Those scribes, those experts, they said this, but I brought them to you, Jesus. When you bring your boy to Jesus, what is Jesus saying about your boy? I think you also have to not only beware of the advisors, but you got to be clear about what you're seeking. He didn't say, Jesus, Jesus. You know, my boy's got this going on and everything. Jesus, will you just pat him on the head and tell him he's going to be okay? Jesus, will you just tell him to straighten up and fly right? Well, that's not what he said. That's not what he asked. He said, Jesus, I brought my boy to you because he has a spirit that seizes him and casts him down. And I brought him because he needs to be cast out. He needs to be free. And then we've got to do just what the Father did in verse 24. It says, he cried out and said with tears. When was the last time you brought your boy to Jesus, to the doctor, and said, Doctor, everybody else is saying this about the situation, about my boy, but I brought him to you. I'm not taking nobody else. I'm bringing my boy to you. And out of compassion and love and a genuine faith, the tears falling. God, there is nothing else I can do. I've spent everything. I've read everything. I've researched everything. I've heard everything. I've watched this and I've done that. But God, I brought my boy to you. What are you bringing to Jesus? Father, we all have boys in our life. I pray, Father, that as we bring our boy to you that's been thrown in the fire, thrown in the water, and convulsed and foaming at the mouth and gnashing his teeth, becoming rigid and thrown down and convulsing. I believe, good God of the universe, and I've heard stories and I've seen stories where you have delivered other boys. Heard when you delivered marriages. I've heard when you delivered loved ones from sickness. I've heard when you delivered other ones from financial ruin. And God, I believe you can do it. Help me. Help me right now. I don't have a mountain of faith, but help